Excellent, dear. I think that's mission accomplished. That's great.
How many minutes is that?
Enough. Enough minutes.
That's enough.
All you need, as your grandmother said, is enough.
The session was winding down like a bad simile. We'd made our picks and were sat back far from pretty, thinking we had it wrapped up. But like a broke Johnny, we were screwed double that night. See, this narration was all just a setup for a cheap flashback. The kind that hits you like an Irish nun. And it all started the night we got together to record the best bits.
Don't call me stupid.
There you go.
That works.
I'll go into the...
That works.
The best bits. I'll use small words that you'll be sure to understand, you warthog-faced buffoon.
What you just said is one of the most insanely idiotic things I have ever heard. Everyone in this room is now dumber for having listened to it.
You are stupid. You have no taste, a lousy sense of humor, and you smell.
Don't call me stupid.
Hello and welcome. I will forget it. You know what? I'm just going to use one of the old intros that we've done. I'm just going to flash back to plot twists and use that.
Oh, good. Okay. Right. What's motivating the flashback?
Laziness.
It's just like, oh yeah, remember the time.
Hello and welcome to The Best Bits, a movie podcast where we pick our favourite scenes from randomly selected weirdly specific themes. This is Kevin, and of course I'm joined once again by my co-host, a writer of three films plus a Christmas special, and I forgot to say that I've also written one of the films and three episodes of TV, and this is as good as it's going to get. Welcome, Will.
Hello, Poxy Kevin. Remember the time? Remember the time when we did a great
intro? You remember the
intro?
Time?
And we're back.
We're back. Do you know what, though? I shouldn't have done that. Do you know why I shouldn't have done that?
Ken for?
Because my intro has finally fucking changed. It's no longer three and a bit episodes of TV. It's four and a bit episodes of TV.
Fantastic.
I'm telling you. It's on iPlayer. It's an animated kids thing. Alan Keane, who was... on our podcast, he was the showrunner of
an
animated show called The Adventures of Mansour, and he asked myself and another one of our prior guests, Pierce, to help him. And so I wrote an episode of season one and I wrote an episode of season two.
And you know what the gas thing is Chloe gets up at the crack of dawn. And my default channel to put on for her is CBeebies. And one morning, CBeebies was rolling along in the background. And all of a sudden, a new show, and it said on the corner, it says new series or whatever it was. And I went, and I looked at the opening title sequences that appeared, and I went, oh, that's the show Kevin was writing for. And I waited and waited and I waited to see, was it your episode? And it wasn't your episode. Or Pierce's episode.
My episode is 20. Game on.
Game on.
I watched it.
Yeah.
I was like, know what I thought? Because I wrote that 2 years ago, and I watched it and I thought, do you know, that's well written. It's actually, you know, bouncing the line there. It's quite clever.
Whoa.
I had no idea what I had written, but it all came back to me as I was watching it. Anyway, we're doing an episode on flashbacks.
Awesome.
Flashbacks are a narrative device similar to voiceovers that are used an awful lot in noirs, thus that sort of Raymond Chandler-esque type voiceover I did at the beginning. They can be like setting up a scene that's a flashback, a sequence, or a whole film. And there's one thing I want to say before we kind of just barrel into the episode. Because we've done about 70 of these main shows, an awful lot of the really great films, they have more than one good scene in them. So you find yourself, or I find myself, coming back to the same old reliables.
Yeah.
But because of that, I want to sort of just tick off a few right at the beginning to say I'm not going to really get into these because we've talked about them before.
Okay.
One of them is Laura. It was my pick on the Whodunits episode, the Otto Preminger film, which again, like most of these noirs, the reveal is almost a flashback. In plot twists, The Sixth Sense.
Yeah.
I see people.
Where the flashback reveals what the twist of the story is.
They don't know they're dead.
It's a really effective flashback.
Best twist ever.
Pulp Fiction, we've talked about. You're looking at me like,
I was going to mention the Pulp Fiction one because I think it was...
I'm going to ruin your night then. It's a Wonderful Life.
No, I wasn't going to bring that one up. Okay. I was trying to pick films we hadn't. Okay. I do have ones we haven't spoken about before, which is good. So keep going. I wanted to hear what other ones you are saying you're chalking off before we get in there.
Memento, yeah, which came up in Assassins.
Uh-huh.
And Citizen Kane, Red Rum. That's not a flashback, which is a big reveal.
Red Rum?
To the story. Yeah. Isn't it?
It's fucking Rosebud, you dickhead.
Oh, fuck. That's fucking The Shining.
Talk to you, stupid cut.
Red Rum.
I could have gone on. If I actually was, and if I was looking at my notes here, I could have went, yeah, yep. And we would just cruised on by that one and lost all our street cred with the film Critty Atty.
We do that all the time. So don't take anything we say.
That's a fact. You know,
take it all with a pinch of salt.
Yeah, we're just assholes. Dickhead.
You were.
People think I'm
you know
I'm a
what?
Cunt.
Glad you're fucked up.
What are we well, I think it was McKee.
Cunt.
Because I was at the McKee Story Conference. Robert McKee is like one of these big cunt story gurus who was actually a central figure, a peripheral figure in the Charlie Kaufman film adaptation, which is a great film.
I'm going to be a screenwriter.
And I think it was McKee who drummed on about thou shalt never use a flashback. Never use a flashback. I think he was absolute death on flashbacks.
I've told you this before, but his book, I tried to read it, Story, yeah, by Robert McKee, when I was about 21, 22, when I was trying to figure out how to be a good writer, how to figure out what are the steps of writing a good script. I had to throw that book across the room. It was impenetrable and it was so pretentious and tedious and it was lecturing. And I hated it. Still to this day, it's the worst book I've ever read on screenwriting.
Hey, listen, imagine being in a room with him for 4 days. I wanted to throw something across the room at him.
Jesus Christ.
If I was there, you could have thrown me.
Now, I think I would have done it. Listen, he might be a great
guy. Why were you there for
guy?
4 days? Was this a false thing?
It was a story conference. It was, I went and did the McKee. You see a lot of development people who like listen.
Usually in pubs.
Listen their whatever CV. Like, you know, I've done the McKee story conference. It's basically a 4-day course.
People put that on their CV showing off.
Some people, yeah, I think they do, yeah. They do say, oh, this is a thing I've got there.
You can put anything on the internet. Do you know what I just saw a while ago? I just saw on my IMDb, you know, people can have lists, user lists, and it might be like favorite 20 plot twist films, sure, and you'll read through it. Somebody had done their fan casting of a Flash trilogy, and they wanted me to write the third movie.
And whoa.
I thought, how does this person even know who I am? But yeah, people put anything on the fucking internet.
Wow.
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 So I've done the Robert McKee conference, and I will say to you, it was a very arduous 4 days where I was absolutely lectured at for those 4 days, along with everyone else in the room. And, oh God, it was just a very, very difficult time in my life. And I agree with you. I'm not a massive fan of that book. I'm not a massive fan of his philosophy. I'm not a massive fan of him and his ego. And he was death on flashbacks because it says that is lazy storytelling. And you know what? If used poorly and shoddily, flashbacks can be terrible. Absolutely. They could be terrible, right?
Everything can be terrible.
I agree with you. I agree with you. So I want to give you an example.
Except car chases, as I've said many times. Every film can be improved with a car chase.
Always a thing. Or add a brother. I was told that my friend Liam said that to me years ago. He says, add a brother. Things get better. Just add a brother. It'll make things better. And, you know, I was thinking about, let's say, sometimes flashbacks are used to give like extra information about a character's history or some sort of information or past or some sort of narrative information. And I'm thinking,
I should probably tell people what a flashback is, though, because I didn't tell them what it was.
Okay, go on. Say that if you want to. Throw it out there.
Maybe people know, but a flashback is basically, it's basically a moment that happens before the story has begun. So you're getting to go back.
Don't call me stupid.
Before, oh, forget it. Continue. You need to, everyone knows what a flashback is.
You're flashing backwards in time. That's what it is. For a flash of a moment, right? Now, there are stories, like what I was saying, where it can be employed poorly is like, for instance, you know, in The Princess Bride, right? And we have, what's his name? Inigo Montoya. Isn't that his name?
Dumb and stupid.
Inigo Montoya.
My name is Inigo Montoya. You killed my father. Prepare to die.
And there's a moment there where Inigo talks about the history of his relationship with the man with the six fingers on his hand. When Cary Elwes's character asks, like, you know, well, why do you want to kill him so bad? We have this beautiful little moment where Inigo Montoya says, well, once upon a time, this guy came along. My dad was a great sword maker. And he tells the story of how his dad was duped and killed by this fucking asshole.
Do you always begin conversations this way?
My father was slaughtered by a six-fingered man. Was a great sword maker, my father. When the six-fingered man appeared and requested a special sword, my father took the job. He slept a year before he was done.
I've never seen its equal.
Six-fingered man returned and demanded it, but at 1/10 his promised price. My father refused. Without a word, the six-fingered man slashed him through the heart. I love my father, so naturally I challenged his murderer to a duel. I failed. Six-fingered man leave me alive. But he gave me this.
How old were you?
I was 11 years old. When I was strong enough, I dedicated my life to the study of fencing. So the next time we meet, I will not fail. I will go up to the six-fingered man and say, hello, my name is Inigo Montoya. You killed my father. Prepare to die.
You could have told that story as a flashback, but I don't think it would have been as effective because the dialogue and the performance conveyed it really well. You could have easily gone and said, right, flashback this.
If you're just showing somebody something that they're telling you in a scene, then you're just seeing it.
Oh, I'm saying...
But a proper flashback is like... we go back to before these characters met and it changes the context of the story. It pivots off in a different direction.
Oh, so but what I'm saying is that scene isn't a flashback, right? But what I'm saying is it could have been a flashback. And I'm saying,
right, I get, yeah.
there are examples where, like, you know, that was one of those instances where you could have made a flashback out of that scene, but they chose not to. And as a result, you actually have a better scene. And that kind of is maybe endorsing Robert McKee's, philosophy.
Don't endorse any, you know, nothing he says is valid.
I know.
Fuck him.
He's saying, no, you need to work harder. You need to work harder.
So here's how I think you can work harder with a flashback. The flashback has got to push the story forward by going backwards rather than just be backstory. Mm-hmm. Because backstory for me, I don't particularly like backstory in films. Even when it comes to just straight ahead character stuff, I would sooner have my characters defined by their behavior, not their backstory.
Yeah.
So in Grabbers, I know I always have to reference that because what else can I point to?
You don't believe me.
But the backstory in that, I undercut it by it being bullshit. So you're hearing gossip, which is the supposed backstory, and then O'Shea reveals that's not what happened, but yeah. He never tells you what happened. So I kind of prefer us to get to know a character through their behavior, not their backstory. And with flashbacks, I don't love them if they're just there to show us stuff that we don't need mm-hmm. the story to move forward. But if they are something that makes the story pivot or twists, and why it works so well in films like Double Indemnity or Sunset Boulevard or whatever like noir you can think of, is because that's what the story is about. It's about the reveal that we were building up to. So murder mysteries will have them a lot, but I'll tell you a film that I watched which kind of speaks to what he's saying, what I'm trying to say about flashbacks that don't work. is one in The Killers from 1946. It's a Burt Lancaster film with Ava Gardner, and it opens with a fantastic sequence.
You've been asking for it lately. Hey! Any objections?
Yeah.
You touch me and you won't live till morning.
You're not meeting tomorrow.
Aren't I sweet?
Most of them turned out to be unhealthy. The farmer died from natural causes. The Swede and Blinky Franklin were both killed.
You know who else was in the gang?
You were.
Where Burt Lancaster's character is being chased down by two hitmen who are out to kill him.
Mm-hmm.
They find him and they kill him. And the title comes up. And you think, whoa, they've just killed off the star of the film. And I thought, oh, I'm into this. This is great. This is exactly what I want. Still have all that great dialogue that I love from those noirs. But then it spends the rest of the film explaining how he ended up in the point where he got killed. And it felt dramatically dead because I knew how the story ended.
Yeah.
There was no big reveal to it. Versus something like Double Indemnity, where it's all an elaborate, twisty-turny story, and you're not aware of how it ended. You're sort of still trying to figure out what went down. So it's a different form of a flashback. And both of those films, they sort of open, and then they flashback, and the whole story takes place a year prior or several years prior in the case of The Killer.
What's your killers. Point? What you're pointing out there is there are flashbacks where the entire film is mainly a flashback. So we have a framing device of, like, you know, someone opening things up, and what you're experiencing is a reinterpretation of the story from that character's point of view, which is really interesting.
So these are probably more framing devices than flashbacks.
Yeah, it's a framing device. But essentially that entire feature is a flashback, like in Forrest Gump. Because in Forrest Gump, we have the whole thing is told at Forrest just sitting at a bus stop and various people are joining him, and he's just randomly talking about his
just
history.
Just watching him eat chocolates.
Yeah, watching him eat chocolates. But I think the license that framing device gives you is that you have the license to be able to tell the flashback story, which is the main drive of the story, with a certain degree of a filter on, like a, whether it be a nostalgic filter or whether it be a kind of heightened filter, like definitely in the case of Forrest Gump.
Hello, my name's Forrest Gump. Do you want a chocolate? My mom always said life was like a box of chocolates. You never know what you're gonna get. I bet you could walk all day in shoes like that and not feel a thing. I've worn lots of shoes.
But also another film that kind of falls into that category is Tim Burton's film Big Fish, which is all about these stories.
And you don't know whether those things are real because he's a Walter Mitty-esque sort of fantasist.
Yeah, so it's not quite exactly the flashback because you're kind of hearing about stories which are, you know, elevated stories and heightened stories. But you know what I mean? I'm taking that idea, kind of stretching it a bit far in that particular case.
Have you ever written a story with flashbacks in it? Because I haven't.
Yeah, there was, like, golly gee, you brought up Grabbers and bringing up Song of the Sea, a very important moment for me in
Song. I'm looking forward to seeing it.
You should see it at some stage, yeah. In Song of the Sea, there's a moment where Ben, it's about this Ben who's a brother, who's turns out his sister is a little magical silky who has the power to save the entire fairy world, essentially, has lost his sister and a critical part of the story, and he's found himself down in this deep down cave where he encounters a character who was called forever the Hairy Man. And this man has got really long hair that extends all across the landscape, and each and every hair has got a story attached to it. So Ben's way of tracking down his sister is by following her strand of hair. And he follows that strand of hair down a deep, deep, dark hole. And what that strand reveals to him is his own history with his sister, which are flashbacks, which was, it ends up becoming a flashback about the origin of their relationship and the tragic night that his sister was born.
Why did you structure it that way? Why didn't you structure it beginning with that sequence?
Because for me,
I just want to get into the nature of, like, when you structure a story, where does a flashback go? Because you can put it, like, I just watched Deadpool. And Deadpool does a familiar thing over the course of the three films, which is he begins at the end of Act One, and it does the jokey thing of, like, you're probably wondering how I ended up here. And then he flashes back and we go through Act One to get up to the moment of where he is fighting all these guys. And that's a narrative device that you see an awful lot in TV, where episodes of TV will begin in the second act or in the third act as sort of a pre-credits teaser.
Yeah.
And then J.J. Abrams does it a lot, like he did it in the Mission Impossible 3 film. And then they go back to the beginning. And I'm just wondering, like, one of the more difficult questions you have to ask yourself when you're writing a story is where to begin. And at what stage do you think this is irrelevant backstory and this is important backstory, but we need to save it until this moment when it has the most impact in the story?
Well, that's exactly what was the case for me in Song of the Sea, because I'm charting Ben's journey from his state of mind at the beginning of the story, which was he blamed his sister for the death of his mother. You know, he hates his sister. Right, that's what it is. He hates, his sister's annoying, she's a pest, but he is kind of coded to hate her and he doesn't really know why he hates her, but he just fucking hates his sister. Kind of like, it's just, she annoys him. And so the journey that they undergo is essentially a journey for him to get closer to his sister and have an awakening as to, hang on a second, maybe I've kind of pinned her all wrong. And so the flashback is basically, if for me, as a device to hold a truth mirror up to the character's face about themselves. And that, like, reveal is, like, you know, the revelation of his own painful truth. And, like, in Ben's case, the painful truth that he sees about himself is that he blames his sister for the death of his mother.
Where does this come in the story?
This comes, like, near the end of Act Two. Like, pretty much near the end of Act Two, where it's that revelation where the character is been chugging along with a certain mindset or a certain philosophy in their life, and that has ultimately screwed things up for them, and they need to learn and they need to change. So it comes just before the point where he truly changes. So that's where I think flashbacks kind of could be very, very useful, where they are revealing information to the main character and the audience, but the main character in particular in that case, where they can kind of go, shit, I'm only learning this about myself right now, and my God, haven't I a dickhead, and I should change my ways.
Mama. I can't wait for the baby to come. We're going to be best friends, aren't we?
You're going to be the best big brother in the world.
When you talk about flashbacks, you'll often fall into the territory of non-linear storytelling.
Right.
Because of the age I am, I only became aware of a film that did non-linear storytelling quite successfully with Pulp Fiction.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, after Pulp Fiction, because that felt radical at the time. It was a story that began in the middle, went backwards, caught us up, flashed forward. And it was just, as Tarantino was saying at the time,
audiences, as long as they're in good hands, they like being curious. They don't like to be told everything. If they think that they're in good hands, if they think the storyteller will eventually take care of them, they can wait if they think it's not a mistake, if they think it's on purpose. Now, the way that three-act structure was supposed to work was this. The first act, everybody in the movie knows so much more than we do. All the characters know what they're talking about. We don't know what they're talking about. All the characters know what they did. We don't. Everybody in the movie is way ahead of the audience. The second act, the audience hears the whole story and catches up with the characters. The third act, the audience now knows more than the characters. The audience is so much more hipper about what's going on and what's happening than any one of the characters in the movie.
That inspired, like, a whole host of other films that came after it, like Go, 21 Grams, Rules of Attraction, Amores Perras, Babel, Lock, Stock and Two Smoking Barrels, Irreversible, where the film basically goes backwards from one of the most horrendous opening sequences. There's a big difference between what's a flashback and what's just non-linear storytelling. Because I would consider Pulp Fiction, Forrest Gump to be non-linear storytelling.
That's an interesting one.
Versus Shawshank Redemption, which would be definite flashbacks. You know, going back to the court case that, you know, he arrives in prison and then flash back to how he got there. And
yeah, like for me as well, classically, we have flashbacks, like, you know, there's framing devices, but then the very, very classic kind of definition for me of a flashback is you reach a point in the story where some information, where something triggers a character to think about something in the past, where it's like, and then we go back to that point in the past and it's like, oh my God, this is new information and a kind of, sometimes it can be used for exposition. Like, as you brought up there with Pulp Fiction, there is a brilliant classic old school flashback scene within that non-linear film when we see Butch, Bruce Willis's character, has thrown the fight. He's on the run from Marcellus Wallace. He's a wanted man and his girlfriend had to kind of like pack everything up. He's in the motel and she says, he asks her, "You got the gold watch?" And she goes, "Oh, baby, I forgot the watch." And it's like, forget the watch. But we get the flashback to, okay, well, why is this watch so important? So the narrative kind of, this is one way you can employ a flashback, is like if the fucking story sets up a question in the audience's mind as to why, you know, in this instance, why is the gold watch important? Well, we get an absolute brilliant flashback to Butch. You know, it's a classic scene with Christopher Walken. He talks about the, you know, the watch being stuck up his dad's ass and then Christopher Walken's ass for fucking 7 years. And now here you have it. And it charges the present for us as the audience because we now understand why Butch has to go back. He comes from a long line of very honorable, proud, straight-laced men. And now he's not a soldier as he's the generations before him were. He is now a criminal. A deadbeat. And the one thing he had to hold on to was this watch, and he's fucked it up. So it's kind of like, in essence, kind of like him holding on to it. Like he's the last bit of integrity that he has. He needs to go and get it.
It's my father's fucking watch. You have any idea what he had to go through to get me that watch? I don't have time to go into it, but he went through a lot.
And that's an example of how a flashback can charge the present day kind of narrative, we'll say. So I think that's a pretty great flashback scene right there, the one with Christopher Walken.
Are there any flashback scenes you can think of that are rubbish?
Oh, lordy. When ones don't make any sense. Oh, God.
I remember a really terrible one in Spider-Man 3.
Oh, tell me, what was that one?
It was when they retconned the death of Uncle Ben. So it included the Sandman.
Oh, God.
I told your uncle all he wanted was the car.
What is it?
I need your car.
He said to me, why don't you just put down the gun and go home? I realize now he was just trying to help me. And then I saw my partner running over with the cash, and the gun was in my hand. I did a terrible thing to you. I spent a lot of nights wishing I could take it back.
You don't want your flashback to be a retcon.
Yeah. Or I think if a flashback is plugging plot structure shit, you're in trouble. Yep. If it's revealing something about character motivation, then that's pretty cool. Or it's kind of like deepening. I think deepening, revealing our understanding of what it's basically adding extra texture and layer and depth to what we already understand. If it's plugging holes in a sinking ship, that ain't good. Which, speaking of which, Titanic essentially is a huge flashback.
It's been 84 years.
From that old lady on the boat.
That's true. And then, of course, you've got films these days which are basically prequels that are de-aging people and plugging them into stories as flashbacks. Yeah. So from X-Men 3 onwards, you know, where they began that story with Magneto and Professor X.
Charles Xavier, Professor X, yeah.
It was. Yeah, where they go and they recruit young Jean Grey. But we've seen it so many times now. They keep doing it in films where they are de-aging actors to squeeze in an extra story. And
you know what isn't bad storytelling, though? Is one that...
We're going to talk about Song of the Sea again?
No, we're not going to go Song of the Sea. I think you get away with flashbacks more, though, in animation than you do in live-action films. Because in animation, you can be a little bit more creative and a little bit more visually interesting in how you execute it. Like, for instance, there was one...
Because a flashback isn't a prologue. Like, you wouldn't call the beginning of Up a flashback.
No, I wouldn't consider it a flashback. I would say that's a prologue.
Nobody would, unless they're stupid.
Yeah. But in Up, right, there's a moment where... And this is one of the scenes I wanted to talk about, where they're building up to this critic. What's his name? Ego. Anton Ego, played by Peter O'Toole. He comes to the restaurant.
Oh, you're talking about Ratatouille.
Sorry, what did I say? But in Up, there's a moment. Oh, sorry. So, God, I need to do it again, Kevin.
No, no, I'm leaving it in. Anytime God. I can reveal that I'm the one correcting you, I'm leaving it in.
And you're completely
Pobot?
Absolutely.
Plastic
yes.
surgery.
That's right, girl.
You're doing complete plastic.
That's right, girl.
Complete plastic surgery on all your own gaffes, Rosebud, you dickhead. For me, in the case of Ratatouille, there's an excellent one when we have the restaurant critic who comes to their restaurant and they serve him the dish Ratatouille. And he's been such a talismanic object of fear and cold, critical thinking. But when he gets this dish, he takes one mouthful. And it's a really excellent use of a flashback because the camera just slams into him. And it's just beautifully presented. It's like two shots of him as a child standing in the doorway of his home. And he's got a scratched knee and he's bawling his eyes out. Then he's sitting at the table and his loving mother just slides this warm dish of
shit
ratatouille in front of him, and we just see him melting, and then we cut back to the present and we see that same expression on his face and that dour fucking cold critical head just melting away. That was a really effective use of a flashback in that moment because it just gave us so much about his past, and it gives us kind of like, you know, his relationship to food and where it was formed. And it was, that flashback is 5 seconds, maybe. No, 10 seconds long. That's all it was. It's really good. Really effective.
It's actually 7 seconds long.
Is this?
No. Just trying to quite dig in.
But it just goes to show. It can be done really effectively and powerfully there. Doesn't plug a plot. It's not a plot thing. You know, it's just deepening that character's, I suppose, his personality or his history. That's what it's doing.
Mm. Yeah, it's unlocking his past so that his future will be changed by it.
Yeah, and when we get that wee dot at the very beginning of who he was, we kind of see, you know, we can imagine in our mind's eye kind of like his life journey. You know what I mean? When you get that beginning, that, like, you know, that formative moment for him as a child to him now, you go, oh, I can kind of imagine his entire life. It adds up. It just
you
makes
can bridge
sense.
It all. It all makes sense. Yeah. Yeah. It's like learning what somebody's star sign is, it then all makes sense.
It does. Or it's one of those bloody personality test thing you can do online where you answer like a million questions and you end up giving them your bank account details and they say, they scan your, no, I'm joking. But there is that personality test, which is very creepy when they come back with the results because it all makes sense.
Or I find if you meet somebody's family, now it all makes sense. Now I know who you are because your mother's crazy.
Yeah.
And your dad's a lunatic. Yeah. You know? Your parents were English, not Irish. It's like, oh, it all makes sense now.
Whoa. That's why
you're so screwed up.
That's why you don't know that potatoes are better than walkers.
I was in a pub the other day and we had the North of Ireland potatoes and I cannot taste the difference. I can't taste the difference between the two different potatoes. They both taste the same to me. And I flash back to having potatoes at home in Cork.
Yeah.
And it was like that moment in Up, you know, where it
goes. where the food critic is. Yeah. You know, right.
And the barracuda eats all the eggs. And I was like, oh, and that's how he got his fin damaged. No, I don't know what I'm saying. Yeah.
One. Well, I want just very, I know we're going to get people cancelling on us, right? If I go into the Tato thing. But the other night.
Going to? I can't lose anymore.
Yeah. The other night, I was at a function. We had a whole sheep racing thing up in Ligony, which is great crack. And that night, they had a box.
Save this for a mini bits.
Okay. Okay.
Come on over to our Patreon. It'll be the next thing you hear at the end of this episode. Well, Will's going to tell us about his sheep racing event.
All I want to say is you're talking about food.
I'm going to cut it out. Whatever you say, I'm going to bleep it.
All I'm saying is, I know you're actually bleeping right now, right? Fuck you. I'm going to say it. Several people came up to me and says, you have to eat the crisps. Eat the fucking Tato crisps. Like several people said, just have a pack. And it was a proper pack of Tato cheese and onion crisps.
They were saying, eat the butt.
They were just eat.
You have to eat the butt.
Eat the crisps. Eat the crisps. And I ate the crisps. And oh my God, they were right. There was magic in those little crinkly packets.
What crisps?
Classic Tato cheese and onion crisps.
Have you not had them in a while?
I've had them a lot recently, but this particular box was like the heroin version of them. And I don't know what made them special, but they felt like me going back to my childhood of this brimming bag of Tato that felt like it never ends. And the flavor was just really, really strong. And I just went, these came from the 1980s. They were like kept in a shelf and must be a decade out of date because they were just magical.
All right, because we're now rambling and we're off topic, what makes you flash back to an earlier time in your life, other than Tato's? Because I can tell you something that I was just out the other day. It was a very, very hot day. It was about 32 degrees, so I was in my shorts.
Yeah.
And the sun was going down. It was about 10 o'clock at night, and there was that chill in the air, the breeze blowing against my bare legs. And it took me right back to being a kid again, to being out all day in the hot sun, and the sun is going down and you're thinking, I've now got to walk home and the night's over and it's been a good day or whatever. And it was just a sense memory of like the cool summer breeze on my bare legs. I was right back to being like 7 or 8 years of age in Cork.
Yeah.
Weird, isn't it?
It's sense memory stuff. For me, the most recent stuff is just today. We're packing up our entire lives and
quitting the podcast.
I found a box of old video VHS tapes that I had from when I was a kid that I'd held on to, just like it's a couple. And I even picked up like one and it's got the Terminator written on it and I could see the writing and the weight of the tape in my hand was just, it was the sense memory. Even, you know, with VHS tapes, you could press the button and flip the top and the way it flipped back and everything about it was just like, it was just a sense memory. I could imagine myself putting the tape in and just watching it again and again and again. So so texture, sense memory.
Do you have any totems of nostalgia that you hang on to? Are there any like childhood toys notebooks or anything like that?
Just a couple. I've held on to a few. I found like a couple of my childhood toys, but not that much. There's just a few.
I don't have any because my fucking aunt gave them all away. If you remember when I told you that.
Yeah. But come here, we should get back on to flashbacks.
Well, I've only got one film left to mention, so I'm done.
Okay.
So you can vamp.
Okay, I'll do one before my main pick, right? And I'm going to stay in the realm of animation. And I want to bring
up
a film.
The problem for me is, because we're rushing through this, I just want to say,
yeah,
because we've talked about so many of these films already, I don't want to be repeating myself. It's like, go back to the plot twist episode, go back to the whodunits episode, go back to the assassins episode. Those are the scenes, those are the scene topics where I've talked at length about a lot of these films. And I don't want to sort of be repeating myself too much.
Yeah. And also, I'm just aware, so this is just off mic as well, Kevin.
So we're talking for 40 minutes. Just we're on 40 minutes right
I
now.
I know. It's going to be a very short episode. I'm going to have like 15-minute long clips.
Oh. Put them all in. Okay. Well, actually, do you know what? There's three, actually, I want to bring up. So
Well, these three, we've never brought these three up before, my final three.
Go
so
for
I'll
it.
Talk about two.
Hit me.
So there's two in particular. I'm going to stay in the world of animation. As I said to you, in animation, I think it's a lot easier to execute flashbacks and for it not to feel like you're just kind of, you know, fixing plot holes. And I think these are moments which reveal and deepen our understanding of the characters. One is from my arch nemesis Pixar movie, Soul. I call it my arch nemesis Pixar movie because it's the film that won the Best Animated Picture Oscar.
Oh, I was going to say, because I really like that.
Wolfwalkers. There's a really elegant and beautiful flashback moment in that because it's a story about a jazz musician whose goal in life is to write his masterpiece, but he's never actually achieved it. He always feels like his life will be fixed. His life will be better once he's got this piece done. It's always the crown, the treasure is just over the hill. Once he's done that piece, he's got everything sorted in life. And of course, that's not the case. And he's always fails to actually finish it or figure it out. And it's not until he's sitting at his piano and he's bereft of ideas and just bereft of his own talent and everything, that he just takes out some random items that he's been collecting in his pocket and just throws them onto the table beside him. And these items just trigger little mini vignette flashbacks of his normal life, like him eating a slice of pizza and just that the moment of joy of eating a slice of pizza. Him cycling on his bike down a road, seeing the sun come in and out of cover through the leaves above his eyes, those little moments of just joy and
such a good scene to flash back and, well, and set up inspiration happening.
It's inspiration happening. Exactly. We are getting within the character's head and we are experiencing those moments with him, and we see how those moments then fuel this piece that comes out of it. But it's also this character realizing and having an appreciation, life was good all along, I actually have the perfect life.
What you're talking about there, I'm remembering I did a whole episode of a podcast for Promenade that was about nostalgia, and it was about being triggered to my childhood based on a couple of things. One was I heard a song that I hated at the time, but hearing it now years and years later, and it was Aqua's Barbie Girl, it took me right back to walking up Cathedral Road up to my nan's, because it was constantly on the radio and I just remember that walk all the way up the hill. And it was funny how the context had changed, because I've not heard that song 20 years. To suddenly hear it again, it was like, whoa, it took me right back. I still don't like it, but it had a different effect on me. And the other thing was just sitting on the stairs of my nan's house reminded me of sitting on the stairs as a kid. And yeah, that's a good episode to, I don't know, pad out this topic, talking about just nostalgia. Because I guess flashbacks can be used for two things. One is to reveal plot and show you what you thought had happened didn't actually happen. Or it is something, as you're saying, it's a realization for a character that springboards them into the next chapter of their life or the third act or whatever.
Yeah. It's definitely shouldn't be employed to give vital information for the story to even exist in the first place. You know, that's
rules. Like, you don't want to get to a stage and then it's like, well, here's the thing you need to know.
Yeah.
And then you flashback.
That's crap. That's a bad example of a flashback. There's another one from Pixar. They've done them so well. There's one in Coco, which is kind of heartbreaking and even more heartbreaking to me now. And it's I'm sure everyone has seen Coco, but it's
I haven't.
Have you not seen Coco?
I don't like animated films.
Oh, right. Okay. I should have known that by now. Well, basically there's a song in Coco, right? That it's Remember Me, right? Is the name of the song. And it's played in various different styles and kind of like tones throughout it. But ultimately, it is sung in a way by this little kid whose grandmother is almost nonverbal. She obviously is over the road with dementia. So there's a flashback in Coco, right, which is anchored by a song, which is Remember Me, which is sung several times throughout the film, you know, as a jolly tune to begin with, and then it becomes a little bit more melancholic. But ultimately, at the end, we see it when it is played to, you know, this kid's grandmother, who hasn't spoken at all throughout the film, and she's on death's door, essentially. But her grandson, in desperation to try and save someone who's going to disappear, you're going to have to watch the film that I was talking about, he plays a song for her, and it's a really beautiful moment where he's singing the song Remember Me on his guitar to this old lady, trying to get her to remember and flashback to that person that sang it to her, which turns out is her dad. And a beautiful thing happens, and the little old lady, who hasn't really said anything throughout this whole film, begins to sing along. And I've just said it, but it's a really powerful example of, if you can find the right moment to organically use a flashback, it can just blow you away, because you'll see all the little pieces, like a piece of picture that up to this point you thought it meant one thing because this man's face was ripped out of the picture, but in actual fact there's another reason that face was ripped out of the picture, and it's revealed in this moment. It's absolutely stunning. It's heartbreaking. And like, look, a part of what happens, as I know now, with people who have dementia, is that they lose one part of their brain, which is like the facts and the places and the history. But what they hold on to are feelings. They hold on to music and poetry. And I think there's and our connection is held on to, like our feelings towards people is held on. And that can be triggered via music, like we were talking about the sense memory thing. That stuff is still active even in people with advanced dementia. And it's in Coco, it's just dealt with beautifully. And I think it's one of the best examples of a flashback out there, where it's like it feels perfectly placed. It feels like it adds so much weight and depth and gives us a new understanding of the story. It twists our perspective on the story totally, but it's very gentle and very organic.
Mama Coco, your papa, he wanted you to have this.
Mama, wait.
Remember me. Though I have to say goodbye, remember me. Don't let it make you cry. For even look, if I'm far away, I hold you in my heart. I sing a secret song to you each night we are apart. Remember me. Though I have to travel far, remember me. Each time you hear a sad guitar, know that I'm with you, the only way that I can be. Until you're in my arms again, remember me.
Elena? What's wrong, Mika?
Nothing, Mama. Nothing at all.
Is the whole movie building up to that scene? Like, is that the scene that justifies the existence of the story? Is that why they told it?
Yeah, it is. The whole film does kind of build up to this point, absolutely. It's a revelation. The whole thing is a kind of a revelation in this moment. And so if you haven't seen it, it's well worth a watch. It's a really great film.
My papa used to sing me that song.
He loved you, Mama Coco. Your papa loved you so much.
You're getting to see the puzzle pieces all assembled, and you pull back from it, and you can now see what the puzzle was all about all along.
Yeah. My pick is from a childhood classic, a film I absolutely love. It is Stand By Me from 1996, Rob Reiner's adaptation of The Body. And that film,
I'm trying to remember a flashback in that.
Well, that film, okay, is essentially the entire thing is a flashback, right?
Because okay, so this is where we were talking about, like, with Titanic and with, I can't remember what the other film was, where it's like, is that a framing device?
It's a framing
device. Or is it a flashback?
But there is a flashback within Stand By Me. So first of all, it is an example of a film that is it's framed as a, you know, in a flashback framing device. But there are a couple of flashbacks within that film. And one for me that I that really rings true and kind of hurts deep still to this day is a flashback that happens really early on where we learn that Will Wheaton's character, Geordi, his brother, this is the story takes place in the summertime, his brother, Danny, his older brother, who was the golden child of the family, was tragically killed in a car accident like that April. And his parents are still grief-stricken. But we get like two flashbacks with Danny, played by John Cusack. And in those flashbacks, we get to see why Will Wheaton's character, Geordi, feels so invisible in this world and why he feels like he is never going to be seen and he's desperate. And it was because John Cusack was such a wonderful, glowing, golden child of a son. And by comparison, Will Wheaton can never live up to those expectations. And I just think that flashback kind of sets a kind of an undertone to Geordi's character for the entire film, because you know that back home, there's this real ache happening back home.
That the real family he has are his friends.
Yeah, and that his buddies are right there. And to cap that off, the final scene of the film, which is back with Richard Dreyfuss, is Geordi as an adult. He's at his desk and he's writing this story, and we actually just see him write the last few sentences of the story. It's so beautiful. Richard Dreyfuss doesn't say it, he just types it on screen and we see the words going on screen. And the words are effectively, "In truth, I never had friends like it did when I was 12 years old." And he said, "Jesus, does anybody?" And it's fucking so powerful. It really is so powerful. Yeah, that's my pick.
Last week, he entered a fast food restaurant. Just ahead of him, two men got into an argument. One of them pulled a knife. Chris, who had always made the best peace, tried to break it up. He was stabbed in the throat. He died almost instantly.
Dad, can we go now?
You ready?
Yeah, we've been ready for an hour.
Okay, I'll be right there.
You said that a half hour ago. Yeah, my dad's weird. He gets like that when he's ready.
When the night has come and the land is dark and the moon is the only light we'll see.
Yeah, it's a beautiful film. We talked about that in Coming of Age, I think. But that's one of those films that made me feel nostalgia for a period that I never experienced. I never experienced the 1950s in wherever that was in America.
Yeah.
You know, you can relate to walking along and feeling the summer breeze on your shorts.
Yeah.
On your bare legs and feeling like a kid again. And you know what? It harkens back to what you were saying earlier on about just put a brother in it.
add a brother.
Yeah. That's a lovely film, and it's one of those films that always makes me ache with sadness.
Yeah.
Even when I was a kid, when I'd watch it, I'd be like 14, 15, and I'd feel like, oh God, I don't want to grow up because I'm going to miss out on knocking about with all these lunatics.
Yeah.
And beautiful film. That's a really good pick. The thing that I like about doing this podcast is thinking about topics I wouldn't have given much thought to, other than I have a basic take on it, which is I don't really like flashbacks unless I absolutely have to do them. Also, checking out films, particularly because they have a flashback in them or they're known for their flashbacks, and then discovering films that I like. So I enjoy it for that. I went back and I revisited my pick for this and I watched it again and it made me nostalgic for the films that were coming out in the early 2000s when I feel like cinema had peaked. The independent films were being made on a studio budget and they had ideas behind them and film looked its best. And it feels like that was the period where we basically peaked.
Oh my God. Are you going to bring up, you're going to bring up Lord of the Rings?
No, I'm not.
Oh shit.
Are there flashbacks in?
Yeah, there are a couple of flashbacks in Lord of the
Rings. Galadriel talks about the fucking, the, you know.
How
they got the ring.
Became magic born. Yeah.
Oh yeah. I love those films. I watch them every Christmas.
Come on.
No, it's Eternal Sunshine of a Spotless Mind.
Of course.
Hello, I'm Howard Mirziak, founder and president of Lacuna Incorporated. Why remember a destructive love affair? Here at Lacuna, we have perfected a safe, effective technique for the focused erasure of troubling memories. In a matter of hours, our patented non-surgical procedure will rid you of painful memories and allow you a new and lasting peace of mind you'd never imagined possible.
This is a hoax, right?
I assure you, no.
Is there any risk of brain damage?
It's on a par with a night of heavy drinking. Nothing you'll miss.
It's a gorgeous looking film. It's got a great ensemble. But when you think of like flashbacks, this plays with the idea of flashbacks. The whole story is about being able to erase people from your life who've caused you pain. And what I didn't realize when doing my research for this was that the idea didn't start with Charlie Kaufman. He was brought on as a writer for hire. Michel Gondry got the idea from an artist friend of his named Pierre Bismuth. And he was having a conversation in the 80s with a friend of his.
Can you hear me? I don't want this anymore. I want to call it off.
Who had just had a breakup and he said to her, you know, would you prefer to have never met that guy, to have your memories erased? And she said yes, and that idea stuck with him. And so he told it to Michel Gondry. Michel Gondry and them developed an idea based around that, and the idea of like being able to send cards to people and tell them that you have been erased from this person's memory, although they never followed through on that. And they sat with it for years and years and years until Charlie Kaufman was like the big hot writer, you know, with adaptation, and he was sort of making a name for himself. They brought him on board. And then they developed it from about 1998 onwards. And there was periods where he wanted to back out of the film. This is Charlie Kaufman.
Yeah.
Because of Memento, which I thought was fascinating.
Wow.
Because Memento obviously deals with flashbacks and memories and things being corrupted. And the thing that he struggled with was the scene that I have picked out. And it was, for him, it was making the character lucid within the memories, to be able to transform what happens within the memories and to remember stuff while he's inside this lucid state, to be able to change what happened in his memories so that he only really loses them completely when he wakes up. And it's quite a twisty-turny story, and there's lots of like great magical trickery that they do with, you know, moving walls out and scenes being truncated together, where he'll walk from a library and the lights go out and he turns into the house of these other characters, and it's all these great trick shots. But at the midpoint, like, my favorite sequence in a script or any film is the midpoint. It's the moment where the story, as I've said to you on other podcasts, it's a moment where you think you've been sitting down for dinner and then you just flip the table over and it's like, you're not having dinner anymore. We're now going to have a fucking rave or whatever. And it's the moment when he is pushing back against this process, which is taking away these memories, and he's telling Kate Winslet within his memories what's happening. He's becoming aware of it, and she says to him, well, why don't you take me to a place where they don't know where I am, so those memories can't be erased? And so he goes back through his childhood, back to memories where she didn't exist, and he implants her in them. And it has this cascading effect where he's changing his reality within his own life.
Yeah.
And she is getting to know him. It's been the big struggle in their relationship, is that he won't open up to her. He's constantly guarded. Kate Winslet, in that she's almost like a manic pixie dream girl, and she's that force of nature character that comes into a very reticent, diffident character and pulls him out of himself and then destroys him by being too much of a free spirit. But in that sequence, the character almost arcs and he becomes a more open version of himself, where she gets to know things about him that he'd never revealed to her before.
Mm.
And the story goes on from there, and it's cross-cut with what's happening with Kirsten Dunst and with Mark Ruffalo. He looked like a kid in it. It was funny to see Mark Ruffalo again.
So young.
Realize that he was just a little boy in that film. But it's a very clever way to play with the idea of flashbacks,
yeah,
and the nature of them, turn them into these magical realism sequences that are almost like dreams as well as nightmares as well as fantasies. And it's such a clever film. It's so intricate and beautiful, and it's all built around a relationship where two people come together, have a connection, they render each other asunder, they go their separate ways, they don't want to ever have to deal with the painful memories of that, come out the other end not knowing each other and fall back in love with each other again. Mm. But this time they're aware of how bad things went and they still want to try and give it another go. And it's a great film.
Joel.
Mm-hmm.
I have another idea for this problem. This is a memory of me. The way you wanted to have sex on the couch after you looked down on my crotch.
What?
Joel, the eraser guys are coming here, so what if you take me somewhere else? Somewhere where I don't belong. And we hide there till morning.
Man, I can't remember anything without you.
That's very sweet, but try, okay?
Okay.
It's one of those films that
I'm
could
to come
really easily have worked as an animated film as well. And like David Lynch's films,
absolutely,
I think that film could border on being incomprehensible and so confusing because it's madly moving from one memory to another memory. But I think it works because I think it captures how our memory works or how we perceive our memories, which is, we do flow from one to the next. We can jump around time quite easily in our own brains. So it's something that's not alien to us consciously or subconsciously. So I think it pulls it off. It's a great film. I haven't watched that since the cinema, I don't think. That was 2002 or 2003, I think. I'm not too sure.
2004.
Oh, is it? Okay. Yeah, I haven't seen it in 20 years now. God.
No one ever looks at me. I want my mommy.
Oh, baby Joel. Hey, Joel.
Is every little peanut under there okay?
Mm-hmm. He's fine.
It also is one of those kind of films that I love where it's inclement weather. I love films with bad weather.
Oh, right. You'd watch more Irish films, though.
That's depressing weather, but I mean, like, you know, they're walking on ice and it's snowing and you can see their breath and it's raining and stuff. There's atmosphere. You feel part of the world, and I don't want to be out in it, but I do like being able to see. It's like ASMR where you're just, it's, you know, there's rain falling outside of a crackling fire.
Yeah, I love it.
But no, when I was thinking of flashbacks, that's one which plays with the whole notion of flashbacks. And the story is built upon that premise.
Mm.
So it's my pick. And I've never used it before.
Excellent.
There you go, Will. That's another one in the bag. And no
flashback.
As per usual, I'm going to spin the wheel for you. How'd you like that? How'd you like them apples?
Well, I don't think I've quite gotten used to the agony that sound induces in my brain box.
What are you not wanting?
Best films that have had at least 10 installments in them.
And here we go. It is best carry-on film.
You shit. God damn it.
No, but it is in the comedy realm. It's buddy comedy scene.
Okay, that's good. I like that particular type of film. Let's go for it.
So with buddy comedies, now can we just include like buddy cops and whatever, where it's like we can just have duos anywhere a film is based on two stars coming together?
Yes. And things being funny.
But not rom-coms. Kind of like, important. You know, partners in crime type things or
this platonic relationships.
Yeah. Okay. That's a good one. We've never done this before. Holy shit. We're still finding little avenues to explore. Okay, so the next episode is gonna be buddy comedy. Oh, wrong sound effect.
Okay, very good.
That's the one.
Well, I am looking forward to it, Kevin. I can't believe we're managing to squeeze these episodes out.
I know.
But particularly, things are crazy. But fair play to us.
Fair play to me.
And
fair play to you. Odd couple, that's what we are. So we should. That should be right in our pocket. Next episode from us, buddy comedies. In the meantime, come on over to our Patreon. You can get all these bonus episodes from us. We're going to record another one in a little bit. We've got 70 odd of them. I think it's nearly 80 actually. Audio commentaries, the works. And if you don't want to do that, you can write us a review on any of your podcast apps of choice. It really definitely helps. And we'll be back to you soon with another episode. In the meantime, we'll see ya.
Hasta luego.
Ciao. As they said in Up.
Alright, good luck.
The Best Bits podcast is produced by Will and Kevin. All audio clips and music heard in this episode is the intellectual property of the respective copyright holders and no infringement is intended.
If you enjoyed this episode, please consider becoming a Patreon member, where you'll receive bonus shows where we talk about recent releases and what we're up to.
And you'll receive access to our Discord chat room where we hang out with our listeners.
Search the Best Bits podcast on Patreon or click on the link in the show notes.
Rosebud, you dickhead.
And here is a clip from the lad's latest Mini Bits bonus show. The full episode, plus 100 more, are available on their Patreon.
Yeah! Mini Bits.
Well, the Best Bits boys are at it again. With the jokes and the jives, driving me insane. Wish I had a shotgun, I blow my own brain. Listen to these bastards laughing and complain. Well, the Best Bits boys keep them talking shit. Once you get a job, the other just quit.
Play dumb and stupid.
Yeah, the Best Bits boys, the rascals on the mic. Once a guinea bitch, the other take a shot. The Best Bits boys, they're at it again. Yeah! I still enjoy the pain.
Kevin, what's going down?
What's going on? Not much. What about you?
Oh, you know, this is my last time recording in this office.
Ever.
Not ever.
This is the last episode.
Not ever.
Anyway, it's been great fun, everybody. Thank you.
This is the last time I'm recording an episode from this office because we are on the move.
Ken Four.
We're on the move, Kevin.
We're
on the move. And
caravan's loaded up.
Yeah, we're becoming nomads. That's the plan. Becoming nomadic people.
Traveling all around the country in your horse and cart.
Yeah.
Look out for Will.
Do you ever remember?
Bring along your DVDs, he'll sign them for you.
You were probably too old to remember Wanderley Wagon.
Don't you mean too young?
You're probably too young to remember.
You just looked at me in the camera and thought, yeah, it's got to be old. It can't be young.
Yeah. You were too young. But Wanderley Wagon was a children's preschool show that was on RTE for your time, because it was almost before my time. And there was a lovely theme tune to that. So if you want to insert that theme tune right there, be a nice little musical.
I love how you always please team me up for more editing. You said it on the last episode as well. The thing about Roy Keane was like, if you find the thing there with Roy Keane, so cut that in. And I thought, yeah. God, will me, fuck. I'm just trying to get the episode done. You're not good looking.
But yes, you'll find the time to find 17 different various fart noises.
and I record them myself.
To the bathroom. Oh, can I tell you about something wonderful that did happen in my daily life in Donegal here? We had the thing called the Legany Sheep Race.
Tell us about the Legany Sheep Race.
Ah, so Legany is a little community townland outside of Donegal town. It is up in the Blue Stack Mountains, kind of bordering Tyrone, the north of Ireland. And it's a wonderful community. It's kind of like the heartland community where my wife, Karen, comes from and all her family are up there. And we're actually moving up to that townland. And we...
So watch out.
We had a... It was... The original Legany Sheep Race happened in 2008. It's a fundraiser for the hall, and for every year they donate, every time they do it, they donate the excess funds to various charities and stuff like that.
Like the Legany Bingo Hall, that charity and stuff.
Yeah, it's the Legany Bingo Hall, the Legany Drinking Society, the Legany Knitting Club.
The Legany Beer Garden.
The defunct Legany Film Club, which I set up and ran for one season. Maybe I'll do it again.
I don't know. Held in a shed with a corrugated roof, if I can remember correctly.
Kind of,
which is great. Yeah, acoustics for watching films.
Bad idea. I think I could revive it now, though. And
you sent me a video of the Legany sheep racing thing from about 10 years ago where Karen's dad was one of the ushers.
That's right, yeah.
Who was
showing
the sheep where to sit. Yeah. And
Hey, over here!
It looked mental. So what? Do people put bets on? They race the sheep?
And I'm one of the bookies in the tents, right? I'm certified and all that sort of shit. And the odds are better than if you go to bet on a regular horse race, because you're guaranteed a minimum 3-1 payout if you win. Guaranteed. It's like...
How does that work?
How it works is, I'm giving you inside baseball, it's completely random. There's no such
illegal
thing as... No, it's not. That's not illegal. It's all for charity. So what it
is... prohibited.
So how it works is, right... We sell the sheep beforehand. People sponsor the sheep. Like I sponsored a couple of sheep so I can name them, and I should have named one the best bits. That's what I should have done.
What did you name it instead, Kevin?
Oh, I got Luke. Luke named it. He was big into The Simpsons. So instead of Santa's Little Helper, he named it Shepherd's Little Helper. So that's where.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Lame.
People bet on the sheep according to the name. So the favorite name was the one that got the most bets, you know?
See, if I was there, I would have named the sheep the funniest names for the guys to be shouting out. Where it'd be like...
Yeah. Lady Baba was one of my favorite ones.
Mad Granny is coming up the back. Here comes Mad Granny.
Yeah. It was great crack. So how the odds work out is basically we tally the amount of bets that are put on a particular sheep. Let's say if there's Mad Granny gets, so we know you're able to figure out 25 bets. As soon as the sheep race starts, we correlate all the bets, the amount of bets each sheep gets. Whichever sheep wins, X 20 people have to spread it out, so we're going to give them 40% of the winnings.
Do you know what? I'm following all of this and it's all making complete sense to me, and I know exactly what you're on about, and I guess we can move on from there. But it was a good day.
All I'm saying is, right, it's just an anchor for today. It really is a big family fun day to show the kind
of... And do you whip the sheep?
No, we don't whip the sheep. You don't whip the
sheep.
What,
you shoot firecrackers at them?
You don't.
That's awful.
You get nice, young, virile...
Children
charming.
To chase the sheep.
That's kind of it, yes. They chase the sheep around, and people were online... complaining, says, oh my God, the poor sheep, this is a disgrace.
You saw my message.
Sheep are given the juiciest hay. It's about a 30 second gallop, you know, and they're given the juiciest hay afterwards, and they're left out in a lovely fresh field full of grass, and they're happy out.
Was anybody like slipping in a bit of sherbet into the hay to sort of like spice up the sheep?
Well,
fired up?
No, but I want to give you
I want to
everyone left smiling. Right? Because children are free. It's like children don't bet and children are free. We had tourists come up because they were like, Donegal gets a lot of tourists.
From Roscommon.
Some of them. Roscommon. But to give you an example, some American tourists got a bus out to the hall. They thought it was, there was no such thing as contactless, no card machine out there. It's all cash. They had no cash. So they were let in for free and they were given, each of the kids given €5 each.
So the Americans got the charity.
So they get, well, that's the spirit of the people, then the community up in Legony Hall. It's like, no, you've no money. Come on in. It's okay. It's okay. Here's some money. Go on. Take the hall. Take it. Take it. You know. Take a sheep. They left with...
That's nice. That's nice to feel part of a community like that. So usually down in Cork, it's like you might get together and burn out a car and stuff like that. But beyond that, it's not really much, you know, that brings the community together.
It's lovely. It's really lovely. We'll share a link to some videos from highlights from the day.
The video I saw, I was stunned. I couldn't believe that she raised 200 sheep at once.
Mental. As at the children.
Alongside the cliffs as well. Yeah, I couldn't believe it. Crazy. Unreal. Anyway... talk about some films, Will?
Yeah, I would love to talk about Alien Romulus because I just watched it last night.
Many bits.